Parkinson's is what we call a movement disorder, and that's because it impacts our movement. So those are the symptoms that we commonly associate with Parkinson's: a tremor or shaking, slowness, stiffness, trouble walking. So those are the classic or the cardinal symptoms of Parkinson's. But the thing about Parkinson's is that it's much more than a movement disorder. There's a whole other side to Parkinson's that's not movement. These are things that can affect you from head to toe, anything from memory and thinking changes to mood changes to sleeping problems to constipation, urinary and sexual changes. So really, it's a whole body disease. It impacts a brain chemical called dopamine, which is responsible for normal movement, which is why we see those movement changes come out. Other brain chemicals that impact our mood and our motivation and our cognition, those are all involved. So it's much broader than just the movement.
Could you help us and the audience kind of describe the distinctions and the overlap between specifically Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease? How would you differentiate between these two?
There are a lot of similarities, and for a lot of people, it can be hard to know what's what. At their core, they both involve the brain, of course. They both have proteins that fold or change abnormally. So in Parkinson's, that's a normal protein called alpha-synuclein. And we see that in the brains of most people with Parkinson's, that protein folds abnormally and clumps up and is associated with those damaged or dying dopamine cells. Same goes in Alzheimer's. We see normal proteins that fold or change abnormally. And so those are things like amyloid beta. So we know that we have links and what we call pathology in the brain that's linked to these different conditions. Now, in Parkinson's, not everybody develops significant cognitive changes. Memory and thinking changes can be part of Parkinson's, but like all symptoms in Parkinson's, they express differently and to different extents and degrees in different people. So some people might experience just trouble multitasking, whereas they're used to juggling 1,000 things. Now it's really hard to get through 2 or 3 at the same time, or what we call executive dysfunction. So like planning and processes and those sorts of things. In Alzheimer's, similar kind of memory changes, although they may be more along the lines of forgetfulness, especially early on, not remembering what people told them or not being able to keep track of appointments or things like that. In Parkinson's, people who live with the disease for many years and oftentimes decades sometimes do develop more significant changes. And what we call that is an umbrella term called dementia. And dementia simply means significant memory and thinking problems that are impacting the day-to-day. So it's hard to, you know, do your grocery shopping or pay your bills or drive a car or just live independently, because all of those things that we once were able to do without thinking about them now become just much more challenging because our memory and our thinking are involved or are impacted by this disease process. Alzheimer's is the most common cause of dementia. That's another reason for this significant memory and thinking changes that can happen.
What are some of the most prevalent theories for what causes Parkinson's disease, whether it's inherited, environmental, or sometimes even injuries? If you could shed some light on that.
It's complex. So genetics certainly can play a role. In some people, it plays a bigger role than in others. But we think in the vast majority of people who have Parkinson's, it's really this complex combination of factors that are coming together to bring it on. And those factors are really, as you said, genetics, environment, and then aging. So we're all getting older. Age increases our risk of many diseases. Cells across our body turn over. They get damaged and die just because we're living. And so that's just part of normal aging. Doesn't mean that disease is part of normal aging, but it just means that increases our risk for diseases like Parkinson's. Genetics is really, really complicated because it's not a one-to-one. In some diseases, we see, oh, we find the genetic link, and that definitely means you are getting Parkinson's or you aren't getting Parkinson's. It's not that simple. There are multiple genetic links that we found that increase risk of Parkinson's. But again, it's where you live and your surroundings and what you eat and whether you're exposed to pesticides or head injury, et cetera, that may push you toward Parkinson's or push you away from Parkinson's. So it's that interaction of our genetics and our environment. We see that there's an association between things like head trauma or head injury, pesticide, and other chemical exposures, those sorts of things that can increase our risk for Parkinson's. On the flip side, we see some associations that can actually decrease our risk of Parkinson's. And those are things like caffeine, even tobacco in cigarette smoking, which we always say we wouldn't recommend anybody go out and start smoking as a way to decrease their risk. But it's interesting what all these associations show us are links that, again, we can capitalize upon to learn more about what might be bringing on the disease and causing the disease, and then also how we can intervene to hopefully stop it before it progresses to the point where we recognize it today.
You, more than anybody, know that Parkinson's can be a very emotional condition to come to terms with. What kind of recommendations would you give people who are perhaps going on the journey from diagnosis to treatment, management, and with research getting stronger all the time, hopefully at some point, management of the symptoms where you can actually even see some reversal of the disease? What do you know about all of that?
First, I tell people you're not alone, and it's so normal to have a variety of emotions, sometimes all at the same time when you have Parkinson's. And it changes like it does for all of us. It changes throughout life. And at diagnosis, we often hear from people a mixture of relief. Many people have been seeking a diagnosis or knowing something has been wrong for years. And because it can be challenging to diagnose Parkinson's, or maybe because you don't fit the standard idea of an older white gentleman, maybe you take longer to get a diagnosis. And so for a lot of people, it's relief. It's validation that they knew something was wrong. It's also somewhat comforting to have a name and to know what's going on, because you can then make a plan and you can address it. But of course, it also comes with uncertainty, anxiety, grief about what your future may look like that might now be different, or things you may lose or feel like you've lost already. And then over life with Parkinson's, as things change and symptoms increase, or maybe new symptoms come on that impact how you can interact with other people, say it's harder to project your voice, or there are symptoms you have that you feel embarrassed about and you don't want to go out and have dinner with your friends anymore, or you can't get out of the house as easily. And so some of that independence feels like it's being taken away. I think the biggest things to remember are, one, these are normal. I think so many of us, Parkinson's or not, we're afraid of emotion, or we're afraid to express it, or if we do express it, that's going to make it bigger. And that's simply just not the case. By expressing it, we actually are sharing it with other people who can help carry that with us and want to help carry that with us. So whether that's family members, physical and occupational therapy, mental health professionals, social workers can be so helpful in guiding you through and processing, even not just you, but even as a family, talking through these things together. And then the Parkinson's community, there's so many people who understand what you're going through and are willing and want to share and guide you along. There's so many people who say, oh, Parkinson's, oh, that's what Michael J. Fox has, or that's what Muhammad Ali had, or that's what Neil Diamond has. So as people come out and share their story, it not only puts a name to it, a face to it, an experience that people can relate to, but it also fuels the community and it fuels research. Michael J. Fox said he knew he had something to do when he was diagnosed with Parkinson's. And like many, it took him years to decide how he was going to share and be public with it. But he established the Michael J. Fox Foundation in 2000, so over two decades ago, with the goal to close our doors and go out of business. We want to find a cure, but along the way, we want to find tools to help people live better lives with Parkinson's today. And the Michael J. Fox Foundation is the biggest funder of Parkinson's research worldwide and has funded over $1 billion in research, which is just absolutely incredible. And we've certainly got more work to do, and we're sober about that and realistic, but we're passionate and we're dedicated and we're coming to work every day really with the goal to help improve the lives of people today as we work toward a world without Parkinson's.